So our word is accelerate. Accelerate means to gain speed by taking decisive steps. Before I go any further in my message, I have a song for you guys.
It's somewhere I can't stay. I don't know why he made growing up, but I guess that we're all gonna. Yeah, I don't know a lot of things, but I know why God made mamas. For the open arms to fall into, for the when you don't know what to do.
Anything in that song that wasn't true. So all my pictures today are going to be of women because it's Mom's Day. So guys, this message is for you too. Like, it's not just for moms, but all my images are moms, so get over it. All right, so we're going to talk about how we can accelerate in 2003. Our scripture verse today is out of Hebrews 12, 1 through 2. And that says, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. And let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. I'm kind of a word nerd, so I got you the exact meanings of accelerate. It means to begin to move more quickly, to increase in amount or extent, and to undergo a change in velocity. Have you guys, any of you ever experienced that feeling of accelerating? I know my husband has lots of stories. about accelerating because he was not very safe when he was younger. Yeah, he has lots of stories. Now, I'm the complete opposite. This one has paper on it, sorry. I'm the complete opposite. I was always like wanting to stay safe. I didn't want to get hurt. I'd rather, you know, if someone's going to get hurt, it be somebody else, and I would just learn from their experience. That's the type of kid I was. So I do have a couple of childhood memories that can go along with the word accelerate. The first was when I was about 8 or 9. The picture is really hard to see, but I'll explain it to you. I grew up on the coast, so we didn't get snow very often, right? When we did, it was like a skiff on the ground and the schools were closed down. So if you wanted to go and experience snow in the winter, you had to go find it. So that's what my family and another family, my parents' best friends, that's what we went and did this day. We went and found snow. And being the timid person that I was, I let everyone else go first down that snow run before I would go. I wanted to make sure that it was safe because I didn't want to get hurt, right? So in the background here, down the hill is just a forest of trees. And right over here to the far left, you can kind of see something. That's my sister Jamie. My dad right here looking back. Our friend John Way, who is way taller than my dad, and they were, my dad and John were standing at the bottom of the hill with their arms up, ready to catch us if we went too fast, because down the hill further was trees, and we didn't want to go into the trees, right? Well, unbeknownst to me, when you go on an inner tube run over and over again, it gets more slick and more slick, right? So I'm the last kid down this inner tube run, and I'm smoking fast. Like, I'm about to cry because I'm going so fast, and I don't know how to stop myself. I went so fast, you can see them all looking backwards because I flew over the top of them. They were not tall enough to stop me, and here I am over in the corner of the picture. I landed on a stump and knocked the wind out of myself, but I didn't go down in the trees. That's a good thing. Obviously, Jesus had other plans because I did not die that day, but I thought I was dying. Like, I could not breathe because the wind was knocked out of me, and I thought I was dying, but I didn't. That's not a very, like, dangerous story, but to me that day, that acceleration was a bit too much, right? Okay? I have one more story. One more pic. So, Levi, this next one's a picture. Okay. So, any woman who decides they want to ride a motorcycle, this is what you want to look like, right? I had to throw that in. This is not what I looked like, but this is what I wanted to look like. When my parents moved us up to Washington, we rented some property that kind of had some pasture land. My dad had a Honda 250, and we got on it and rode around the pasture land. We thought we were really cool. I was like 17 years old. I thought I was super cool riding a little bike around the yard. The rule was, though, that we had to wait until my parents were home to do this. Because we didn't have a whole lot of experience, but we had fun doing it. So I was 17, and I decided I did not need to wait for my mom and dad to be home to take a little jaunt on this little bike around the yard. So I know, right? So I got on that thing. I started it up, and this is how I felt I was doing. Go ahead, Levi. You have to tap it to play it. There you go. This is how I actually did. I couldn't believe that I found something that fit so accurately to what the experience really was. I banged, well, actually what happened is there was a tree, and I wasn't wearing a helmet, and I had my hair in a ponytail, and that tree limb snatched my ponytail and yanked me right off that bike. It was bad. Like, I had the proof all the way up my legs. That bike, it ate my leg up. I did end up breaking something on the bike. I can't remember what it is because I'm not mechanical. But I tried to hide it. I, like, put the bike away, put on jeans so that my parents couldn't see my legs, right? My dad gets home, and it didn't take him very long to find the broken piece on the bike. And I was like, yeah, sorry about that. I don't remember much after that, but so sometimes we come to a quick stop, right? That was that day that I came to a quick stop. So I think that Hebrews 12, 1 and 2 gives us the key to acceleration not ending abruptly. That is keeping our eyes on Jesus and running the race that he marks for us, right? Sometimes we get off path and we kind of want to do our own thing. But if we don't want our acceleration to end in pain, it's a really good idea to stay on the path that Jesus marks for us, right? I'm going to do what you guys are probably tired of hearing about and talk about the pandemic just a little bit. It's not the whole sermon. In March 2020, everything shut down, right? We all learned a new way of life. How we worked was different. School was different. Church was different. Socializing in general was different, right? Everything was different. And we lost a lot in that 3 years. But we gained a lot too. The lives of our loved ones, we've lost so many loved ones, right? The kids lost a lot. They lost the ability to socialize in a healthy way. A lot of them lost time in their education. They lost being able to have face-to-face conversations. That's been weird getting over. Juniors and seniors in high school lost out on college scholarships because sports weren't happening anymore. I don't know if everyone's thought about this, but the juniors and seniors lost a lot. Driver's permits and license were delayed because you couldn't even get into the DMV. We learned that. We went through that with Levi and partially with Ben. Getting into the DMV was a joke. It was horrible, right? And our kids weren't the only one affected. The only ones affected. The church was affected as well. We came to almost a complete stop for a short amount of time. And we used that time to quickly learn what we needed to set up online. And that, I mean, thinking back on it, it felt really hard at the time. And now it's like, wow, that was just a short time. It didn't end up being super long. But it felt long at the time. And even though things came to a halt, we were still growing. Did you guys realize that? We were still growing even during the pandemic. Ladies' coffee hour at the coffee shop became us ladies making our own coffee, grabbing a blanket, and driving to a parking lot, turning our cars all backwards so we can open the back and sit in the back and talk. That's what ladies' coffee became. We didn't let it stop us because we're women and we like to talk. That's it. That was it. Yeah. To be able to meet again in church after a certain amount of time, we spread out our chairs, right? And we had hand sanitizing stations, and some of us wore masks if it made us feel comfortable. We did what we needed to do, and we didn't let the pandemic stop us for long, right? And I find it really ironic that 2020 was the year of vision. That was our word for the year. And it ended up meaning something completely different by the end of the year than what we thought it was meaning at the beginning of the year. And we don't always understand what something means until we walk through it, right? God doesn't give us all the answers up front. And that's why faith is so important. Hebrews 11, 1 says, this is the next one, Levi. Faith is the confidence that what we hope for will actually happen. It gives us the assurance about the things that we cannot see. That's faith. So we gained some things from the pandemic as well. We gained time with our families. And we implemented a few new things into our household. I don't know if anyone else did this or not, but all of a sudden, everyone in our house had their own night that they had to cook dinner. And it was amazing because I didn't have to cook dinner every night. For a while, you know, I had to hold their hand a little bit and tell them, okay, to cook this, you have to do this. And I learned some things. My boys learned a lot about cooking, and I learned a lot about my boys. I learned that Levi loves to cook. He's really good at it. Ben doesn't want to have anything to do with cooking at all. He'd rather have someone else cook for him. And Sam likes to cook if he gets to pick what he's cooking. Don't tell him what to cook. But if he wants to look up a gluten-free, sugar-free cookie recipe, then he gets really inspired. He likes to cook what he wants to cook. And I think that the biggest thing that we gained from the pandemic was mental health issues. That's not a good thing to gain. If you pay attention to words that were barely spoken about before, they're basically being shouted from the rooftops. Words like depression and anxiety. The difference between this generation and previous generations are they are not afraid to say these words. I remember growing up, you did not talk about it. These kids today are not afraid. Words like triggers, depression, anxiety, social phobias, suicide, self-harm, and eating disorder. These are all words that we're hearing from teenagers right now, even in the church. And I looked up some statistics. One, this is for Oregon. One out of every five youth, one out of every five, have experienced a major depressive episode in the last year. That's the highest in the entire nation. Oregon has the highest. So what does all this have to do about Accelerate? You guys are probably wondering. Most of the time, when we think about the word Accelerate, we think of cars and motorcycles and going faster, things that make us go forward, things that make us go fast. And I believe that depending on how big or long the fall is, we can accelerate in the wrong direction as well. When talking about the mental and physical health specifically of our kids in the last couple of years, they are experiencing that acceleration backwards, or they have experienced that acceleration backwards. They were going in the wrong way. And during a time in their lives when they're supposed to be learning how to spread their wings and fly, they were being told to stop, to wait, to be careful, to be cautious. They were being told, you don't want to die. Like, those are things that these kids were all being told. We see several examples of this acceleration to death or acceleration to life. That's two things here in Romans chapters 5 through 8. And there's lots of them. Can you guys read that? Oh, cool. So I love Romans. I'm learning about this in my college class. And so I just copied it over and put it up here for you guys. So on the left hand is the examples of acceleration to death. On the right hand is the acceleration to life. I'm just going to read a couple of them. In Romans 5:21, sin reigned in death. And also in 5:21, grace reigns through righteousness. Okay, so we can choose accelerate to death, accelerate to life. The Bible's giving us examples that it's our choice. In 6:16, slavery to sin leads to death. And also in 6:16, slavery to obedience leads to righteousness. That word obey. let's pick another one here. Sin, in 7:8, sin produced in me every kind of covetous desire. And in 7:6, by dying to what was once bound us, we have been released from the law so that we serve in the new way of the Spirit. So these examples show us that even the Bible talks about there, we have ways that we can choose to accelerate to sin that's veering off of the path that God has for us, or we can choose to accelerate to life, which is just choosing Jesus and saying yes to him and following his word. His Bible is our guide to what we need to do, right? When we have questions, when we don't know what we're supposed to do, get in the word. It is our guide to what we're supposed to do to follow Jesus. I have never experienced or seen more of a hunger in our youth wanting to experience God than I have this year. This year has been, I've never seen more of a hunger. They're hungry. Levi, can you go to the next one, please? This is Amplify. Where were we just at? There you go. These are kids who already know Jesus, who are already being deployed to do what he's told them to do, the gifts that he's given them. These are all kids who's already been made that decision, worshiping and pressing in and wanting more of Jesus. And I can't help but think how many more are out there that are this hungry that haven't heard about Jesus yet, right? These kids are done waiting. Their time to accelerate is now. These teenagers, like I said, have already given their hearts to Jesus, and they are so hungry, and they're ready to do whatever it takes. Can you keep going, Levi? These are more pictures. And I think I mentioned it already, but one of these services was, we had a student that had an evil spirit that was being cast out in the service by youth. And I've not seen that. Go back one, Levi. I've not seen that kind of hunger where there's so many kids with their notebooks out taking notes during a sermon as I have this year. Usually kids are sitting there on their phone doing I don't know what on their phones during the services. But this year was exceptional. I caught them taking notes during service. It's something we tell them to do, but to actually catch them doing it was amazing. These kids are so hungry. They're hungry for more of Jesus. And it's really our job to show them more of Jesus, right? Matthew 28:19, Jesus tells us, therefore, go and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. That's the next slide, Levi. Here we go. This is my question to you today. Are you going to accelerate to death or life? And who are you taking with you? That's the biggest question. Who are you going to take with you? I would hope that we would choose to accelerate to life today, right? I mean, choosing to accelerate to death is not the answer today. We need to choose life, and we need to choose to take others with us. Our job is to make disciples wherever we are, right? It doesn't matter if you're at home praying for people. It doesn't matter if you're at work, and you come in contact with a lot of people and you get to share Jesus with them. It doesn't matter if you're a stay-at-home mom and you are sharing Jesus with your kids, because that is our biggest job, right, is to share Jesus with our kids. That's our job, is to make disciples. We're missionaries in our homes, in our communities. But our job isn't to get people saved. That's God's job, right? We're supposed to share the good news with others. And Jesus continues in Matthew 28:20, teach these new disciples to obey all the commandments I have given you. And be sure of this, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. So not only do we need to be sharing Jesus with others, but we need to be teaching these new Christians how to follow Jesus, right? Sometimes that's through teaching a class in Sunday school or kids' church, volunteering to help. It could be by becoming a teenager's mentor. We have a few of those now, and I think that's amazing that you guys have stepped up to do that. It could be as easy as taking them out to coffee or to lunch and just chatting with them, asking them about their life, about their world, how things are going, and sharing with them a little bit of Jesus. It could be a phone call or a text message every now and then, just saying, hey, I'm thinking about you and I'm praying for you. You guys don't know how much that means. It means a lot. Adding them on Facebook, if you do Facebook, and intentionally posting things about God's word over and over again. I think that sometimes that we make discipleship too hard. Like, we think of the word discipleship and we're like, well, you've got to go to Bible college and you got to do this and you got to do that to be able to disciple anybody. But that's not what God's word tells us, right? God's word tells us that we need to live a life of being a discipler, that we tell people about Jesus and then we teach them about Jesus. We tell them and then we teach them. And sometimes we get to use words. Our lives should reflect Jesus. So sometimes we don't even have to talk about him, right? We just need to reflect Jesus. It's easier than it sounds like, but we like to make it harder. So I also notice at the end of verse 20, Jesus gave us a promise. He promised that we wouldn't have to do it alone. I know that when I first started coming out of my shell and being super shy, which I'm still an introvert, but I'm not quite as shy as I used to be, it was hard to tell other people about Jesus because that's not who I felt that I was. But Jesus promised us that he would be with us, and we don't have to do it on our own, and we don't have to do it in our strength. In fact, it's better when we don't, right? It's better when the Holy Spirit takes over and you don't even know what you're saying and you walk away going, wow, that was super cool. Like, I didn't even know those words. I didn't even know that scripture in the Bible, but God gives it to you. And it's amazing to let God use you to bring others to Jesus. He doesn't just say, go out and do it. Good luck with that. He says that I'll be with you and I will help you through it. So, last screen, Levi. These are my four. These are my four in my home. Well, only half of them are in my home now. Aren't they cute? I just got to take a second. They're super cute, right? These are the four that God has said, as a mama, these are your four right now. These are the ones that you pour into. And then, as a youth leader and pastor's wife, God says, all right, here's some more, right? That's what I get to do. But when we're breaking it down for moms today and for dads today, the kids that are in your home are your first. They are the most important to you to make sure that they know Jesus and they have a relationship with him. Not that they know about him, because even the devil knows about God, right? That they have a relationship with Jesus. As parents today, that is the most important thing. It's not the pastor's job to get your kids saved. It's not the kids' church leader or the youth leader. It's your job as a parent to tell your kids about Jesus and make sure that they have a relationship with him. I certainly don't want to be in heaven without them, because I really enjoy them here on earth. I can't imagine how much more I'm going to enjoy them in heaven, worshiping Jesus together there. So today, my question to you again is, are you accelerating to life or are you accelerating to death? And who are you going to take with you today? You know, Jesus did a huge thing for us on the cross. He took on all of our sins, not only the sins that were already committed, but every sin that was going to be committed. And he gave everything for us to have a way to be able to spend eternity with him in heaven, right? The ultimate sacrifice. As parents, I feel like we sacrifice a lot for our kids, right? And I know personally, I would be willing to give my life for any of them. So God feels the same way about us. And he did. He gave his son's life for us. And that's a huge gift that we need to receive. Amen. I'm just going to ask everyone, close your eyes for a few minutes here. If there's anyone here today who's never received the gift of Jesus in their life, I can't continue today without offering that gift to you. And if that is you and you'd like to receive that gift today, I'd like you just to raise your hand with everyone having their eyes closed. Also, sometimes we get a little off track. Sometimes we start to follow a path that God didn't lay out for us. Sometimes that path looks like a good thing. A lot of the times, the path looks like a good thing, and it's hard to tell if we should be taking that path or not. But if that's you and you've kind of gotten off the path of where God is wanting you to go, and you'd like to rededicate your life and get on the right path today, I'd ask you to raise your hand as well. Thank you. We're just gonna pray together, and then I'm gonna end praying for you. So if everyone would stand with me today, and we're just gonna pray this prayer together. Dear Jesus, thank you for the gift of dying on the cross for my sins. I've gotten a little bit off track, but I want to follow you. Please forgive me for getting off track, and please help me to stay on your path. Amen. Jesus, I just thank you for this group of people, all the moms in the room and the dads in the room. God, I pray that you would heal hearts today that need to be healed. God, I pray that your Holy Spirit would come into this room today and that you would touch hearts where they need to be touched, that you would touch the heart of the mama that wasn't able to have babies, that you would touch the heart of the mom that's lost her mom, that you would touch the heart of the mom that is overwhelmed with a lot of children. God, I pray that you would touch the heart of all the moms in this room where they need it the most. And God, I pray that you would bring your peace in this room. God, I pray that your Holy Spirit would just come in and pour over the people in this room. Moms or dads, we all need it, God. I pray that your Holy Spirit would come in and just permeate our presence today. God, we ask forgiveness for getting off track. We ask forgiveness for our eyes not being in the right place, God. We ask forgiveness for not focusing on teaching our kids about you. We ask forgiveness for not listening when you're trying to tell us where we should go and what we should do. God, I pray that you would help us that you would help us to do the right thing, that you would help us to be on the right path, that you would help us to accelerate towards you instead of towards death. God, I pray that you would be a light in front of us, that our focus would stay on you, and that we would get your message out to other people, God, that it's not about us. We already know you. It's not about us. It's about the people out there in our community that it's dying and going to hell. God, I pray that you would put a fire in our hearts that would burn for the people that don't know you. God, I pray that you would continue to put people in front of us and give us divine appointments that we can talk about you. God, I pray that you would take away the fear that the enemy puts inside of us so that we can choose to speak your name to other people. The enemy doesn't want us to do that, and he makes us afraid. But God, I pray that your boldness would come over everyone in this room, that we wouldn't care what it looks like or what it sounds like, God, but that we would go out with boldness and that we would tell others about you. God, I pray that you would give us divine appointments. I pray that we would not be afraid, that we would walk the path that you want us to walk, even though all of our friends and all our relatives that we're close to, God, may not be walking the same path. God, I pray that you would give us the boldness to walk the path that you have chosen for us. God, I pray that we wouldn't be afraid anymore. I cast out the fear, God, in your name, Jesus. God, I pray that you would help us to intentionally speak into the lives of kids, because they are our next generation. If they don't know you, who is going to? God, I pray that you would help us to support the kids in learning how to go out and tell others about you. God, I pray that you would help us to come up with constructive ways to teach our kids to talk about you, that it becomes something that's easy to do in our homes so that when we're out around other people, it's something that's easy to do. God, I thank you for being here with us today. I thank you for the work that you've already started in lives today. God, I pray that you would just continue. I pray that it wouldn't stop here when the message is over, God, but that it would continue, that we would search your word for what you want us to learn, that we would continue to grow, that we wouldn't become stagnant, that we wouldn't become lukewarm, but God, that you would help us to be what you need us to be. In Jesus' name, amen.
Real quick, thank you, Becky. And I'm just going to ask if you'd stretch your hand out towards Beck. We did pray for her before the service, but her knees have been hurting. And then, of course, this is the second Mother's Day since Mom went home. So, Father God, in the name of Jesus, we just pray for your servant, Becky. And I thank you so much for her, not just as a wife, but, Lord, as a co-laborer in Christ. Lord, just pray that you would strengthen her body, give her the divine prescription she needs and the healing that she needs. And God, thank you. Thank you for the message you've given us today. Thank you that you call us to an account to remember we're supposed to make learners, disciples, as we go about our lives. And so, Lord, I pray that you'd help us to be the moms and the dads to the prodigals in our area, so our prodigals can get it too, because of the reaping and sowing that you have made a law in nature. If we sow to minister to others, then Lord God, then others minister to ours in need. And so again, thank you for that. But God, do pray for your healing touch. Lord, we also pray for our friend Gordon DeArmond, who has been diagnosed with a severity that, Lord, unless you intervene, and we do pray for a divine miracle, Lord, to kick this cancer out right now in the name of Jesus. But God, we just thank you that, Lord Jesus, you're in charge and you are sovereign. And God, you know the issues that are going on in the world today. And we ask you to help us to navigate what's going on, and Lord God, to never give up no matter how hard the fight becomes. So God, have your way in Jesus' name. Amen.
We worship the God who was, we worship the God who is, we worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors, he parted the raging sea. My God, he holds the victory. There's joy in the house of the Lord, there's joy in the house of the Lord today, and we won't be quiet. We're gonna shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place, and we won't be crying. We're gonna shout out your praise. Ooh, ooh, ooh. Shout out your praise. We sing to the God who heals. We sing to the God who saves. We sing to the God who always makes a way. He hung up on that cross, and he rose up from that grave. My God, still rolling stones away. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. We won't be quiet. We're gonna shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. We shout at your praise. Oh, oh, oh. We shout at your praise.
Sing it out.
We were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. We were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today, and we won't be quiet. We're gonna shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be crying. We're gonna shout out your praise. Ooh, ooh, ooh. We shout out your praise. We shout out your praise.
Amen. Y'all like that song? Oh, welcome in. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for this opportunity that you've given us to worship you, this time of joy and peace and serenity, that we can just open up our hearts and that we can just cry out to you, don't care what anyone else thinks about it, and that we can just come into your throne room and just be accepted by you. In your name we pray, amen.
Never fails me, and all my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up to I lay in my head, and I will see of the goodness of God.
All my life,
it's all my life you have been faithful. 'Cause all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, 'cause I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. On darkest nights, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God. Come on. All my life you have been faithful. 'Cause all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, 'cause I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness, come on God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendered now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendered now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. All my life you have been faithful. 'Cause all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, 'cause I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. It's all my life you have been so, so good. And every breath that I am able, and I will sing of the goodness of God. And God, I will sing of the goodness of God. And I will sing of the goodness of God.
He's so good, isn't he?
We gotta sing that again.
'Cause all my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. Every breath that I am able, I will sing the goodness of God.
I will sing
the goodness of God.
And I will the let's just open up this morning. Open up your hearts.
keep you, make his face shine upon you, be gracious to you. The Lord's turn his face toward you and give you peace. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Speak it over yourself. Don't just sing, accept it.
May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, your family and your children and their children and their children. May his presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He is with you. He is with you in the morning, in the evening, in your coming and your going, in your weeping and rejoicing. He is for you. He is for you. Believe it. He is for you. 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 Generations, your family and your children and the children and his children. May his presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He is with you. He is with you in the morning, in the evening, in your coming and you're going, in your weeping and rejoicing. He is for you. 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 He is for making your heart cry.
Everyone.
Amen. keep you. Make his face shine upon you. Be gracious to you. Lord, turn his face toward you and give you peace.
You know, amen means so be it. Is God your so be it? Is he your amen? Is he the one that puts the exclamation point on what you do? Is he the one that causes you to rise up in most holy faith and be able to do and to say what you need to do, regardless of the naysayers, regardless of the whiners and the complainers and the murmurers that need to shut their mouth and zip their lip so that you can do what God wants you to do? Because God wants you to be bold. God doesn't want you to be spineless. God doesn't want you to back off. God wants you to be bold and do what he created you to do. God is not interested in your ability to do something as people allow. God wants you to do what he's given you to do, no matter what anybody else says, especially the murmurers in the background. We all deal with it. We all deal with dumb. And the foolish need to shut their mouth so that those who are bold as a lion would go out and speak what God would have them to say and do what God would have them to do. We are not to back off from the foolish, but instead to overcome them by the power of the Lord upon us with his glory, for his glory, in his timing, in Jesus' name. God, we give you glory today. Give the Lord a clap offering today. Let's give him a clap offering today. You are worthy, O Lord. You are worthy, O Lord. God, I thank you that your voice is louder than the enemy's. I thank you that your voice drowns out the murmuring. I thank you that your voice causes us to remember to ignore the enemy's murmurers, whiners, complainers. God, I thank you that even our President Kennedy, not the thing that's there right now that's a fake, but God, President Kennedy said that the murmurers, the whiners and complainers, they think that it's the only time they have a valid time to open their mouth. But God, I pray you'd close their mouth and you would tie it shut until they repent and come to their senses. So God, you have your way. You be yourself. And Lord, we're coming out of the grave. Satan, we're coming out of the grave. We're coming out of the dugouts. We're coming out of laying around. We're coming out of the what it's been pushed on us over the last 3 years. We're coming out of it, and we're coming out intentionally in the armor of God to do what God wants us to do. And we're going to be bold as a lion because you're the amen. Because you're the amen. We're not. You are. Therefore, you make us the amen in our day, in the physical. But you're the ultimate amen. So be it. Amen. 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 I just want us to sing the beginning part of this blessing not only just over moms, but those that have tried to be a mom, those who want to be a mom, those who've maybe lost their children and they don't feel like a mom, though they've been one. Even if it's only one child, that's enough. Even if it's a miscarriage, that's enough. So we want to pray this over you. Maybe today you're here and you were never able to have kids. We pray this over you too. In Jesus' name, Lord bless you.
Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you. Be gracious to you. Lord, turn his face towards you and give you peace.
This amen's for you.
Amen. 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 Amen.
Lord, I thank you that you're for us and not against us. I thank you, Lord God, that you're on our side. Lord, I thank you that you're on your side. You're on the side of your children. You're on our side in that, Lord God, you're willing to support us and encourage us and help us in what is best for us. Lord, I thank you that you're not focused on our will be done. You're focused on your will be done and on what's best. So God, crush the enemy's influence so we can step over or, well, if need be, on their heads and walk on by and just keep doing what you have us to do. God, I pray that today that moms and those who are moms by surrogate, those who are moms by the position they play in people's lives, God, I pray that they would find fruit for the work. I pray today for those prodigal children and those ones that, Lord God, that have run to prove themselves. And I pray for those children that are missing, the MIAs, those children that are missing today. I pray that they be found today. You know where they're at. You know how that hurts the heart. God, I pray you bring the breakthrough. And Lord, I pray for these babies that are about to be born. God, I pray not only for workers for the nursery, but God, I pray for these babies that, God, that you would anoint them in the womb and cause them to worship you now and come out leading their family in worship. God, would you have your way today? Would you be yourself? Do what you're famous for. Lead us strongly because you're worthy. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah.